Distinguished guests, welcome back to the Yushan Forum. And now we will proceed to the final session, creating mutual social prosperity with civil society. And we will start with a plenary speech by Mr. Ichiro Kabasawa, Executive Director of the Nippon Foundation, where he spearheads the foundation's global projects and initiatives. Prior to joining the organization in 2017, he was a news reporter for 20 years at NHK, and he covered global events as a correspondent in Bangkok and Washington. Please welcome Mr. Ichiro Kabasawa.
Distinguished guests and distinguished participants and ladies and gentlemen, I'm deeply honored for this opportunity to speak at this important forum here in Taiwan. It is a privilege to be able to tell you a little bit about the Nippon Foundation, Japan's largest private foundation, and our commitment to helping people worldwide. The Nippon Foundation is, as I said, the largest foundation, and we have 25 affiliated foundations underneath. So we are really a big group of nonprofit organizations in Japan. First, though, I must take a moment to acknowledge your country's rich history and vibrant culture, Taiwan's open-mindedness, technological prowess, and global perspective are a brilliant example for the rest of Asia. And your innovative spirit and dedication to positive change align with the values of the Nippon Foundation. For 60 years, our foundation has worked to solve problems, both in Japan and around the world. Today, I'm personally responsible for our global work, and it's a role I'm proud of. Let me tell you a bit about my personal journey. I began my career as a journalist, as I was introduced. And for 21 years, I worked as a reporter for NHK, Japan's public broadcaster. I worked in Okinawa, obviously right next to Taiwan. I spent 6 years there. Tokyo, Bangkok for 4 years, and Washington, D.C. for 4 years. I even went to places like Iraq and Afghanistan as a war reporter. Later on, returned to Tokyo as a senior editor, and eventually left journalism to become the executive director of the Nippon Foundation 7 years ago. Through that experience, I've learned that journalism and philanthropy share many similarities. Both aim to identify problems in society. Both highlight ways to fix them. But in philanthropy, we go further, actually creating projects and working with governments and companies to ensure those projects' sustainability. Today, we see big organizations like the Gates Foundation and the Open Society Foundations, established by George Soros, making a difference worldwide. Asia, too, is taking part in the global wave of philanthropy. With foundations in Singapore, Hong Kong, and India becoming more active and more visible, the Nippon Foundation is helping to lead this trend. And last year, we started the Asia Philanthropy Congress, which unites leaders from prominent Asian foundations, fostering trust and collaboration on shared regional challenges. Our partnership with the Taiwan-Asia Exchange Foundation as a vital member of this Asian philanthropic community is another example of this effort. But why do foundations like ours step beyond our nation's borders to work globally? I think the answer is the world is changing, and changing fast. Countries are clashing over their different values. Social gaps are growing, and problems are becoming more complex. Governments and corporations can handle most of our social issues, But as the speed of change increases, more and more people are at risk of falling through the cracks. That's where foundations like ours come in. We can take on risks that others can't, because we're not bounded by politics or profits. So let me share a couple of examples of the Nippon Foundation's work. Following the Russian invasion of Ukraine, I traveled to the border between Poland and Ukraine to explore ways that the Nippon Foundation, as a Japanese private foundation, could possibly provide assistance. And it was actually right after the invasion. It was in March of 2021, so 1 month later of the invasion. The Nippon Foundation, as a drawing on our worldwide experience in supporting people with disabilities, we forged a partnership with an Israeli NGO, rescuing 5,000 disabled people from the conflict zone. By the way, I was really saddened to hear about the recent events in Israel, knowing that I have partners I worked with in Ukraine. My heart truly goes out to all those affected by the ongoing violence. It's just disheartening to see another conflict brewing in the Middle East. Coming back to my speech, Ukraine is home to a large Jewish population, and we were able to leverage their networks for this mission. This innovative approach to international emergency relief, led by multinational civil societies, was met with profound gratitude in the region with limited international support. Another project is the VII of 500, a collaboration with global business leaders dedicated to eliminating workplace discrimination against people with disabilities. Through this initiative, we partnered with 500 companies and their CEOs, including tech giants like Apple. Apple's CEO, Mr. Tim Cook, is deeply involved personally, and also Microsoft and Google, securing both corporate commitment and substantial funding for this crucial cause. This marks a unique joint effort between international business leaders and a nonprofit organization like us. Demonstrating the changing corporate landscape due to the focus on UN Sustainable Development Goals, SDGs, and the trend of ESG investments. Of course, these are just a couple of examples of what we do. As the world changes, our work is becoming more critical than ever. And we firmly believe that civil society and the social sector have a big role to play in solving global problems. In closing, I would like to repeat what I said earlier. Taiwan, with its openness and technology, can play a vital role in developing civil society in Asia. The Nippon Foundation looks forward to collaborating with the people of Taiwan in this field so that together we can make the world a better place. Thank you for your attention, and I'm excited to discuss more during the session.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kabasawa. Please take your seat on the stage. And thank you once again for your insights. Now we will move on to the panel discussion. Our moderator for this session is Ms. Cheryl Lai, chairperson of Radio Taiwan International. A round of applause. Please come up to the stage. And now we would also like to invite the panelists to take the stage. We would like to invite Mr. Linus Shanglin Lee, Secretary General of Taiwan Alliance in International Development. Also, we would like to welcome Mr. Xiao Zhonghuang, Director of National Palace Museum. And next, we're going to welcome Zhang Xiaoxiong, professor and former chairperson of School of Dance, Taipei National University of the Arts. Next, we would like to welcome Ms. Huang Xiu-yi, Director of Diamond Marine World. Once again, a warm welcome to our previous speaker, Ichiro Kabasawa, Executive Director of the Nippon Foundation, who is already on the stage. And also, we would like to welcome Mr. Alan Hao Yang, Executive Director of Taiwan-Asia Exchange Foundation. So we would like to invite a panelist to take the stage, and now I would like to give the floor to Chairperson Lai.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm so glad that there are still so many people stay until the last minute. So I promise you, it will be a very interesting and full of stories and human touch panels compared with the earlier one. And I'm also very glad that we have female moderator and also female panelist compared with this morning. It's good, isn't it? Thank you. And first of all, I would like to pay my appreciation to the Mr. Ichiro Kabasawa-san. Your speech is quite touching and will have your sharing later. And from my right hand, there are so many friends here from NGOs field. I think it's quite special for Yushan Luntan, Yushan Forum, that you have the people from NGOs field to join the discussion. Because whenever I attend the international platform, all the discussion is about politics, geopolitics, current issues, international conflict, or even disinformation. But NGOs' role in this field is quite tremendous, but always neglected. So I'm very happy to have Yushan Luntan invite NGO workers and even artists and film directors to have this panel. Thank you. I believe it's the insights from Dr. Michael Xiao. I guess so. Thank you. I think Linus Shanglin would like to share your experience since your name called Taiwan Ed, that Taiwan can help. Could you please tell us more about your story and your work in this field? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Linus Shanglin Lee. I'm the Secretary General of Taiwan Alliance in International Development, Taiwan Aid. It's my great honor to be here and to share some thoughts about establishing mutual prosperity with social foundation, especially from a Taiwan NGO's perspective. NGO is the foundation of democracy. And Taiwan's experience can prove this message. In the past four decades, Taiwan used to be an authoritarian regime, and now it's transformed the leading democracy in Asia. And during the democratization, the NGOs play a very critical role to push the government for reforms and to mobilize all stakeholders to come together and to make change happen. So if you see the number of NGOs in the past four decades, it's increased dramatically. In the 1990s, we have only around 5,000 NGOs, and so far, it's more than 70,000 NGOs in Taiwan. And not only in the number, if you see the NGOs topic and subjects, it contains every critical issues in our daily life, from human rights to gender, from education to social welfare. So that's why Taiwan now can become the leading country in the region. And among the topics, the international development is one of them, because Taiwanese NGOs not only takes care about the domestic issues, but also want to extend the services to overseas. So according to Taiwan Aid Survey in 2018, we have more than 350 programs all over the world, and most of the programs located in Asia, particularly in the new southbound policy countries. And you, if you see the subject and the topic of the program, it contains everything from healthcare, education, information, gender, community. And not only the development program, it also, Taiwan also has a great rescue team to dealing with the emergency relief. We have a very, we have excellent Taiwan rescue team to provide very immediate assistance to the countries and the people who are suffering from the disasters. So Taiwan Aid is a grassroots NGO platform dedicated to international development and aid. We established in 2013, and so far we have about 30 NGO members. And if you see our NGO members' backgrounds, they are various of their professions. Basically, it's a reflection of Taiwan's civil society. And we have two major goals. One is to strengthen our service capacity. We introduce the most up-to-date international standard knowledge, know-how to our Taiwanese colleagues so they can provide better service to help more people. But at the same time, we also want to showcase Taiwan's NGOs. We go to the international community, we share our technology, share our experience, because we want to work with our Asian partners to do more things. So we are very proud, very happy this year we have the NGO Fellowship Program. It's a professional exchange program, and we invite 10 emerging NGO leaders from Southeast Asia and South Asia. They come to Taiwan, stay in Taiwan for 1 month, they go to the workshop, but not only workshop, they also go to the NGO office to work with their Taiwanese counterparts on a daily basis for 3 weeks. That creates great opportunities for mutual learning and to explore the potential and opportunities for future collaboration. So to sum up, what NGO good at is connection. We connect to people, connect to the government, private sector, and all other stakeholders to make change happen. So we believe Taiwan is one of the best places in this planet to make collaboration because we have great, the most vibrant democracy, civil society, and NGO communities. And we believe that Taiwan can play a bigger role in the region to work with our Asian partners, colleagues, and friends to make change and to help more people in need. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Linus. I'm very impressed about the your NGO fellowship. I was told that some of the fellows are here. Could you please introduce us, your fellows? Where are they from?
Hello, fellows. Please
Hello,
wave
fellows.
Your hand.
Please stand up.
Let's stand up, yes.
Very welcome. Thank you. Thank you for visiting Taiwan, and I believe you have a very fruitful event here. Thank you. And now it's time for my former boss. when I was working at the Ministry of Culture, my boss, Xiao Zhonghua, 市长, to help me a lot. And now he's the director of the National Palace Museum, and he's going to share us the museum's experience on this field. 我们现在欢迎 肖院长, 谢谢您。
Okay, 好, 刚刚我在中午吃饭的时候，就是王理事长有提到哈，就是这一场本来是 NGO 哈，可是现在好像是变得比较多元一点哈。那当然，国立故宫博物院是一个公立的博物馆哈，那为什么会在这个场次里面？因为博物馆作为一个知识传播跟社会沟通的一个工具，它其实也是一个非常容易作为一个对话的场域，所以博物馆在整个社会发展甚至整个地缘政治上面可以扮演什么样的关系，所以这是一个我们可以着力的一个地点。好，那当然故宫博物院的话，它的历史的话就很漫长，所以我们不谈。但是我们在2015年在嘉义创办了故宫南院，那在2017年起每年的9月、10月份的办理不同亚洲国家地区作为主题，然后规划亚洲艺术节。那2017年的话，刚好也是一三论坛开办的这个年份哈，所以也是非常的巧合。那这个活动受到很多民众的喜爱哈，变成故宫南院的一个重点的特色活动。那当然，故宫的典藏大家知道哈，就是很多的文物是来自亚，就是华夏文物哈，来自中国。但实际上，故宫里面也有收藏很多不同地区的一个艺术品，所以作为一个面对亚洲的一个窗口，那怎么样去结合亚洲的这些文物，然后来做展出，是一个故宫博物院非常重要的一个使命哈。那是我自己按还是下，还是帮我按下一页？那我自己按。这是一个很简单的图，让大家看哈。就2017年的话，我们办理印度业；2018年我们办理新加坡；2019泰国；2020蒙古；然后2021印尼；2022哈，越南；2023就今年韩国哈。大家会觉得奇怪哈，就是从新南下，从东南亚一直又回到东北亚哈。明年的话，我们会做那个 Okinawa， 所以这也是一个比较有趣的方式。那之后的话，我们会再回到那个东南亚。那我想在这七年的活动里面，我们面对不同的亚洲的国家地区，然后透过不同的语言文化，然后去做交流。当然语言是一个我们的隔阂，可是透过文化的话，我们可以看到不同亚洲文化的面貌。所以接下来的话是简单的，我不做很深入的一个说明。就接下来印度也是2017年，我们跟印度台北协会合作，那是在那一年的9月份。那活动的话有31个场次，超过13万人的参观人次。那当然我们在活动的上面可以看到有一些很简单的，包括指甲的花纹彩绘，然后印度的传统服饰，类似这样的一个活动。那我们也请了一些有关印度相关的宗教或者文化的人士来做演讲。那这是因为第一次办理，所以在办理的规划的时候，其实他的思考的面向的话是一个开始的尝试。那接下来的话，就在2018年我们办理新加坡业。那办理新加坡业的话，基本上来讲第二年办理，那想尝试改变一个方式，所以新加坡业的话是跟新加坡驻台北办事处合办，那也是在10月份左右，超过50个活动的场次。那这活动里面的话，就是我讲说我们新的尝试，就是开始办理展览，所以我们办理两者文化特展。那这个活动的话也是一个新的尝试。那在这个活动里面的话，因为第一次办， 所以他办理的形式的话，基本上来讲的话，还是有点比较临时性质的一个办理。那接下来的话，2019年我们办理泰国业，那泰国业的活动是跟泰国贸易经济办事处合办的，就基本上来讲的话，它的效果也不错。那另外的话，我们搭配一个南燕的展览。 就是萨瓦代地泰国的文化特展，那因为我看那个时间跑得很快，我就直接跳过去。接下来2020的话，我们办理蒙古业，是跟乌兰巴托贸易办事处合办的。那在这个展览里面，因为故宫有很多蒙藏文物的展览的典藏，所以我们特别办的忽必烈汗清代活佛文物大展，这是一个非常正式、非常丰富内容的一个展览。 那在2021年的话，我们印尼业也是跟那个印尼经济贸易办事处合办的。那在这一年的话，我们办理的 Batik 就是印尼的那个蜡染制品特展。那在2022年办理越南业，也是跟越南经济文化办事处合办。那也是一样，就开始有一个系列的活动，就千年古国，就是越南的文物特展。 那在2023年，就今年，我们办理韩国业，那韩国业的话不是跟代表处，是跟韩国文化协会合办。那基本上来讲的话，有很丰富的活动，有走秀，然后有朝鲜王朝跟清宫艺术的特展。现在正在展出有兴趣的民众可以去参访。那另外的话，故宫南院我们有常设的一个亚洲之品的常设展，就这个展览的话是一个常年性的，然后更换不同的主题，都是针对亚洲地区的制品文物。那另外的话，我们在这个系列里面也经常办理不同的一个活动，比如说像这是宗教文物的策展，跟保存的国际论坛，跟亚洲地区的国家一起合办。那 此外的话，就是我们在活动里面都会搭配一些活动，比如说请新住民妈妈说布施啦，然后那个有亚洲地区的绘本，类似这样的活动。那另外的话呢，南燕也有针对，就穆斯林的话有做一个祈祷师，这个大概就是故宫南燕，提供的一个针对亚洲地区或是新南向的一个服务，或是说做一个交流的界面。那这个部分的话，就是给大家分享，那也许我们以后可以再更加改进。
谢谢院长，谢谢，Thank you，Director Xiao。 And I believe it's very different images from the Taipei's Palace Museum, and that recall me about how Taiwan could be the hub of Asia cultural exchange. Very thank you. And I look forward to next year's Okinawa exhibition. It will be fun. Next, let's invite an artist, a dancer, Zhang Xiaoxiong Laoshi, to share your experience from Cambodia to Australia and now Taiwan. Welcome. Thank you.
Thank you. 作为那个在台湾二十七年的新住民，所以我今天希望用国语来做这个呈现。先谢谢这个大会这个机会，可以跟各国的贵宾们分享一下关于台湾的当代的舞蹈的教育。 艺术它其实是能够激发人类想象力跟创造力，同时抚慰人类心灵的无用之用。它也被看作是一种表达或者沟通的工具或者方式。那么作为人类最古老的也是最没有文化障碍的这种艺术形式，舞蹈它既是一种世界的语言，它也是作为人类所有文明创造中肉身跟心灵最高度结合的形式。 那我们在这个柏林的那个国家美术馆，你都看到这青春女神的姿态哈。这是公元前的一个雕塑，所以我们看到非常婀娜多姿的一个青春女神的一个背影，跟她的前她的前她的舞姿。那这是在罗浮宫的一个牧神的一个舞蹈的一个场面。那作为一种表达跟沟通的工具呢，在舞蹈当中，身体其实是一切行为的核心，因为没有身体，也就没有舞蹈。那么舞蹈呢，需要舞者每天的在拉撑着自己身体的每一组肌肉跟每一个关节，那去形塑宛如艺术品的肉身。更重要的是，既有各种绚丽作用下的内卷或者延伸，将生命中的美好跟希望植入到观者心底最柔软的一面，去唤醒人类在高度发展的社会中尤其是当今高科技的飞速发展中被压抑或者被遗忘的灵性感知。那我们可以看到这舞者怎么样去拉撑他们的身体哈。那后面那个舞者，也就是现在台湾非常重要的一个编舞家，他叫黄毅。正因为这样，作为一种无用之用，艺术包括舞蹈，它被视为能唤醒人类感悟或者是悲悯的最后的救赎。这是2004年我带着学生参加那个新加坡那个国际艺术节。那在图片的那个左手边吧，应该是这四个舞者都是当今在台湾或者是在国际行走的重要的舞蹈家或者编舞家。那这是在2011年我们把格瑞斯基的悲愁交响乐改编的舞蹈带到了北京，其实在传递一个对于战争的醒思跟对悲悯的一个呼唤。台湾大概是世界上人口的舞蹈人口密度最高的地方，除了原住民流传千年的乐舞，也有来自中原的各种民俗祭典，比方说阵头、义阵等等。那这是原住民的乐舞，它是在我们学校当中作为一个核心的教材之一，就是学生必须要接受这个本土文化的熏陶。那原住民乐舞它是其中的一项。那还有比方说宋江阵等等这些义阵，它也是在我们的教材里头作为我们的教学当中的一个非常重要的组成部分。那这是我带着学生去参加那个大戏的绕境时候拍下来的。那作为东方西方文化交汇之地，富有文化包容性的台湾，其实一直都敞开着双臂去包容来自不同国度不同文化的这些讯息。那除了亚洲的传统的舞蹈，那还包括了经由日本传播而来的德国表现主义的舞蹈，以及随着时代发展渐渐引入的美国现代、后现代，当然还有芭蕾舞哈，和欧洲与澳洲的当代舞蹈。那这是我们的印尼的教授科索教授所传授的那个印尼的传统的舞蹈，他也在我们的年度展演里头呈现过。那这支舞是我的作品，叫《无定向风》。那这里用了很多欧洲或者澳洲的系统的当代芭蕾。那前面这个女舞者，也就是第一个台湾舞者进入成为那个国际最顶尖的舞团 NDT 的女舞者，她叫吴孟珂。在近百年岁月中，其实是一代一代人的竭力耕耘，所以使得台湾的舞蹈教育形成从国小到高中的一个教学系统，也形成了六大艺术院校的舞蹈教育网络，为台湾乃至世界输送源源不断的具有台湾特色的而且是国际级的舞蹈人才。那 国立台北艺术大学前身是国立艺术学院，它的舞蹈系在1983年成立，是由林怀民先生创立的。那这个五年制的学程，到了1998年的时候，由舞蹈家罗曼菲女士，她将它就是改制成7年一贯制，就是有3年的高中的学习跟4年的大学的学习。这样一个改制，其实改变了台湾的版图，也让台湾的舞蹈教育更上一层楼。这是在1997年，然后带着学生去参加阿德雷德国际青少年艺术节，那这个也是当年的一个重头戏。那前面这个舞者，他就是现在在德国的平清义。在1997年、1998年第二次去澳洲做交流的时候，就演了另外一个作品。然后这个在图片的左手边那个男生，他就是现在的云门的第二代那个掌舵人郑中龙。那通过这种平等、多元、包容与可及性的当代思潮为核心价值的这样一种观念，他被贯彻到了北医大的这个教育现场，所以慢慢的在20几年间，我们逐渐的建构起全球独一无二的，从高中那7年一贯制啊，到硕博班的这么一条龙的舞蹈教育体系。那经由扎实的、开放的、多元的训练，为台湾和国际舞坛输送了大量的优秀的舞者，以及一批充满创意与实力的新生代编舞家与研究者。这对台湾的舞蹈生态有着重要的影响，并引发国际舞坛对台湾舞蹈教育的关注，他们称之为台湾现象。因为现在在整一个欧洲有150多个台湾的舞者是来自于北医大，当然还有其他有效。那这个是2003年的一个作品，叫《悲歌》。前面这个舞者就于彩琴，她是拼到包许舞团的主要演员，她是《春之祭》的那个女主角。那后面那个女生蔡冠霖，她现在是也在瑞士、瑞典那一带哈做一个独立的舞蹈家。那这个是在2006年参加两岸城市艺术节的时候的一个作品，右手边的那个男生，他叫张建明，他现在是英国后飞曲舞团的排练总监。前面这个就是全球非常知名的舞者简佩如，他得到了很多国际的大奖，包括纽约贝西奖和意大利国家的舞蹈奖。而这个奖项，他是作为台湾人，作为全球的华人，他是第一个获得这样的国际的殊荣。所以在过去20几年间，我们培养了大量的人才，那这里头包括了郑中龙、布拉瑞扬、许芳怡、黄毅、简佩如、张建明、林彦青，包括李珍威，还有一个叫做徐立恩。他们徐立恩跟李珍威都在现在那个战火纷飞的那个以色列的巴奇瓦舞团工作。那这也牵动了我们老师们跟家长对那个徐立恩的一个安危的一个担忧哈。所以在这同时，台湾也涌现了一批年轻的团队，以多元的创意及极具本土特色的身体，不仅丰富了台湾舞坛的色谱，填补了人才断层，也积极地迈向国际。所以我们在国际的各大艺术节都会看到我们的年轻的团队。所以这些无论是个人也好，还是团体也好，他们让世界看到了台湾。这是在阿德雷德的演出，这是在美国雅各之枕的演出，这是在又回到阿德雷德冬之旅。这是香港新视野艺术节的违约创作，那都台湾舞者跟香港的舞者的一个 cooperation。这是国际艺术节舞蹈学院与舞蹈节演出的《春之祭》，这是被外交部委派去多伦多当代那个台湾艺术周的一个演出《离骚》。 所以在北艺大的教学的宗旨里头，全人的艺术专才是明确的目标，在东方西方舞蹈体系这双向探索与贯通中，强调实务的重要性并与社会连接，所以学生会通过社区的连接、偏乡的推广教育、全台的巡回演出，将所学回馈社会，同时也积极媒合国际姐妹院校，推动交换学生以及国际交流计划，借此打开国际视野，加强国际的互动。所以在过去20多年间，不仅积极参与主办了国际的舞蹈节，也建立了亚太青春编舞营、亚太当道舞蹈平台，并借由教育生根计划制定了一系列的南向交流专案。那这四个舞者都进了，两个在云门舞集，那两个是在现在在德国。那这是我们的交换生参加我们的年度的展演。这是在柬埔寨交流的时候，柬埔寨的舞者在传授柬埔寨传统的武术。这是在吉隆坡跟胡志明市那国际民族音乐节上的一个演出客图。那这是在本土的一个，因为疫情，所以我们南向计划中断了一下，所以就转向了对本土的深入的探究，跟创作实地的创作。所以为了一个前瞻的一个部署，我们制定了一些比较切合实际的一些计划，比方说暨里安计划、大师经典重建计划、活水的芬芳、归巢、亚太当代平台、亚太创作平台连线，比方说跟日本的高原市的一个合作，交换那个年轻创意的作品，还有国际交换生、国际外籍生等等。那尤其是在引凤还巢或者多元开放的这样的一个计划，其实我们将台湾所培养出来的舞蹈人才，不管是在本土还是国际，把它引向学院里头，带给他们一个新的一个刺激跟一些新的讯息。那这是在2018年的时候，我们推动的暨里安计划。那这个作品我可能要花一点时间稍微介绍一下，不好意思，我占用了一点时间。
没关系，你请。
在2018年的时候，我们跟国际的舞蹈大师哈，他是巨博，邀请他这个作品《士兵弥撒》。这个作品是创作在1983年，是纪里安先生他在离开了1968年离开了被苏联占领的布拉格之后，他怀着很沉痛的心情，回顾在2次世界大战爆发之前，就是捷克被出卖的那一段历史。然后这个是根据就是捷克的诗人跟作曲家所做的一个交响乐改编的一支舞作。那当时他有问说，你们为什么要这个作品？那我就回答他说，因为我们想传递一个和平的讯息，同时我们也想传递一个在战争的危险之下，年轻人永远是第一线被牺牲的。所以我想这个讯息传递给纪里安的先生的时候，他非常慷慨地说，我给你们。因为他这个作品非常非常昂贵，但是他得到了这个讯息的时候，他没有收我们任何版权费用。所以他作为一个国际的一个人道主义跟一个国际的一个就是人类的一种悲悯之心的出发点，他不仅给了我们这作品，也给了我们另外一个作品《堕落天使》。这是我们参加澳洲澳亚艺术节，这是第一个台湾团队参加澳亚艺术节哈。好，这是我们在欧洲的旅欧的舞者，我们请他回来跟学弟妹们分享国际最新的动态。所以身体是一种身体力行的艺术，它只要有空间、光源、受众，就可以独立存在。但另外一方面，舞蹈与科技自古以来就有着密切的关联，因此媒合产生出难以估量的能量，给人类带来更大的想象与冲击。那北艺大的多样性的艺术资源，其实也提供给各种跨域的合作可能性。不好意思。这都是我们的一些跨域的一个合作，包括实地的创作等等。 这就是黄奕跟他的库卡。所以想象力与创作力是人类社会向前推进的动力。那作为无用之用，艺术是一种人类文明的软实力。尤其这种既古老又年轻的艺术，是台湾不可忽视的文化资产，也是连接国际最轻便最有效的一张名片。那如何让台湾的舞蹈软实力可以累积与发挥更大的能量与作用，这是一个前瞻性的文化策略议题。那今年亚洲与欧洲各国都在积极推动那个艺术舞蹈的发展，它是以国家艺术基金的方式加大对新生代舞蹈家的支持的力度，台湾似乎还有更大的成长空间。以上，谢谢。
Thank you. 谢谢张老师。 Thank you for your stories and all those young talents all over the world. And our hearts and prayers goes to those Taiwan dancers in Israel. I believe they will be safe. They will be safe. Next, let me introduce the director Huang Xiuyi, who just got a very wonderful good news. The best documentary of Taiwan Film Festival and also the Taipei Film Award. Please tell us about the award and also your film. Thank you.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Huang Xiuyi. I'm a filmmaker. And in 2015, I traveled by myself. Yeah, as you see the map, from by the Mekong River from Thailand, Laos, Cambodia to Vietnam, because I was focusing on the river issue. I want to make some footages about the river. So at that time, I traveled by the Mekong River, and I entered a big dam in Laos. This is Zayabuli Dam, which is very important in Laos. And from this journey, I see how the Thailand and the China power influences the river electronic power in Southeast Asia. And also, in this journey, I met some Taiwanese people choose to stay there for many reasons. So it inspired me, want to make a film. I'm curious about many questions. For example, why they choose to stay in South Asia, Southeast Asia, and how they communicate with the local people, how they understand the local culture, and even the life value over there. So, in 2017, I follow a Taiwan shrimp farmer to Myanmar. Can you imagine that a 15-year-old Taiwanese who can't speak in Taiwan English and or Burmese, but he chose to build a shrimp farm over cross and in Myanmar. So it's very difficult for him to make it. And after he arrived there, not long after he arrived in Myanmar, his Taiwanese partner framed him for possessing white drugs and guns. It's a big pity, but fortunately, he met Su. Su is a Chinese mermaid girl, so she can speak in Chinese. And when it's fortunate that Du have a chance to meet Su, so they decide to work together, and they have a company named Diamond Marine World. That is the title of my name. And right now, I want to show you the trailer. How to act.
Oh, 可是我就跟他说，缅甸以前没有消费，现在有消费，现在是不用做别的国家，缅甸阳光就有了，很多消费了，只要你成功，
来，全体，
现在你太阳，等一下，
没有办法，你一定要拼啊，一定要拼啊，我们要来这个所在啊，我们来碰好嘛这样。 你来无成功就是一无所有啊。
第一个是我说过嘛，我们是在革命，但是假如我们革命成功了，就可以改朝换代。
臭屁吧。
啊，事实的，怎样？有实力才能臭屁的。
对对对，来，哇！
Okay, from a business perspective, do and sue didn't success in the end. Why they didn't, why the reason why couldn't make sense was all about the trust. And from the process, I see the language is a key point why they couldn't communicate with each other. Since Sue can translate for do, but Sue couldn't trust in Sue because of the cultural gap, because of the cultural value are so different between Taiwan and mermaids. That's the main reason. And from this perspective, it always makes me think about that Taiwan is an island that combines so many immigrants from Southeast Asia. It's very important, and I think it's very lucky for us to have so many cultures here. And we have so many immigrants here, and they have second generation. I think they are the key person who can lead Taiwan to connect Taiwan and the South Asia, to have a link to each other. So because I'm a film director, I just come back from Yamagata in Japan. I saw many mermaids, filmmakers, and many issues about Southeast Asia. All the whole world is looking at this area. And as a filmmaker, it's my way to show the audience how can we communicate by the filmmaking. So this film will be shown in the next Saturday. Welcome. All of you to see it. We can see many cultural conflicts, and I think the sex appeals on the many failure is very important. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Director Huang. I was told that the Diamond Marine World is a film about trust, love, and forgiveness. But unfortunately, we cannot find it from the theater. The movie theater won't have this film. So come to Director Huang for more information about this special event of the film. All right.
Everyone can search the FB page, Diamond Moon.
All right. Okay, you'll give us your QR code later.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I think we still have some time for Ichiro Kabasawa-san, right? Could you please share more information about your co-workers in Israel? You mentioned that you worked with an Israel NGOs to help Ukraine people, but now Israel need help. So I wonder, do you have any information from them, and how can we help people in Israel right now?
Well, unfortunately, I do not have a lot of information what's going on in Israel, but I have been communicating with my partner who I have been working on Ukraine issue. And she said, since Israel is a small country, relatively small country, so almost everyone has friends or relatives who have been affected by the violence. So the entire country is really depressed, has been really depressed by the violence. But that NGO we worked in Ukraine, they had campaign, so-called purple vest. Vest is like clothes, vest. Purple is the significant color of disability people. So they were prepared to rescue people with disabilities in Ukraine. So now they are on their own project within Israel to do the same thing that they did it in Ukraine. So the conflicted area in Israel, they are trying to rescue people with disabilities and elderly people outside of the conflict area to the relatively stable zones. So she said the lesson they had learned in Ukraine is actually beneficial for them to do this at the moment.
Thank you very much. I believe that the Nippon Foundation, if you have any project for Israel people, I believe the Taiwan Ed will maybe join them, right? I think the people can work together and please keep in touch. So we see that either museum director or dancer, artist, film workers, film directors can contribute to the global field. I believe the scholars also has a seat here. And I would like to introduce Alan Yang Hao, the executive director of this organization. So I believe you has a lot to say, but since the time is limited, and could you please make it within 5 minutes? I'm sorry, you are the organizers.
Okay, thank you for
very few minutes.
Thank you for distinguished moderator. With your permission, may I request to stand closer to our distinguished panelist, so that I would like to make make my remark more interactive. this is the final session of the Yushan Forum, 2 days Yushan Forum. So first of all, on behalf of the organizer, I would like to send my special appreciation to all the panelists and all the friends stand at the last moment. Well, I already say 30 seconds. So I think I will make it very quick, and I promise my presentation will be very informative to entertain all of you. What comes up in your mind when it comes close to Taiwan? When what are the perception of Taiwan among our partners of the new southbound policy? I think this is something that I would like to address for my only 5 minutes. 5 minutes remark. Definitely, people think about Taiwan as a food, the bubble tea, and for the recent U.S.-China rivalry, when it comes to Taiwan, that refers to the semiconductor chips, especially the TSMC, the high-end semiconductor chips. But Taiwan definitely, during the past 2 days, you can explore that Taiwan is more than bubble tea, and more than the dumpling, Din Tai Fung dumpling and semiconductor chips. So what Taiwan means and how Taiwan is perceived by our Southeast Asian countries, friends. I think this is something that I would like to share with you. And during the past 2 days, you come across the new Southbound policy as the public-private people partnership that TAEF has long been advocating. That is a unique practice for the cross-sectoral partnership in delivering the so-called Taiwan warm power resources. And yesterday we touched upon the government-led flagship program as the 4 flagship program in terms of agricultural, public health, and medical cooperation, education, talent training, and also social connectivity and economic and investment issue. But apart from that, TAEF also worked very hard to uncover another 5 action plans, including think tank, civil society connectivity, resilience, and also art and cultural exchange, and also the young leader, young talent cultivation. That is the reason why we gather the distinguished speakers at this unique session to demonstrate the multifaceted approach of Taiwan's people-to-people exchange and collaboration with our partners. And among them, TAEF is proud to address that, to emphasize we are the first institution in Taiwan to conduct the annual survey on Taiwan image and the image of Taiwan business in new Southbound Policy partner country. In this partner country, we need to understand how Taiwan has been perceived by our friends so that we can improve ourselves through collecting those useful information. And we, since 2019, we have successfully done our national annual survey on image of Taiwan and image of Taiwan business in Vietnam in 2019, in Indonesia in 2020, 2021 in Thailand, and 2022 in Singapore. And we are about to announce the new result in Malaysia. Big data matters. So according to the frequency of the respondent, what comes up in your mind when it comes to Taiwan? Food, yes, the bubble tea and dumpling. And this is in the case of Singapore. High tech, this is the case in Thailand. And tourism, this is the case in Indonesia. So this is the big data due to, based on our survey, the frequency of the responses. So I will also very quickly introduce you the image of Taiwan. We have not only surveyed the elite, but also to find some interesting metaphor. So we conducted the thematic dichotomies in comparison. So on the left, up left, you can find from 1 point to 5 point, ranging from indifferent to friendly. So those dichotomy shows how Taiwan has been perceived among the respondent. And these are the some of the chart. So I come up with the table to summarize the result. The overall point from 1 point to 5 point. The 5 point means very positive, and from the 1 point, 0 point means very negative. So the overall point of Taiwan among the respondent in Indonesia are 4.4, and in Thailand they are 4.1, and in Singapore are 4.2. But we didn't design that in the first survey in Vietnam, so there is no data. And when it comes to the dichotomy, you can see the top three perception. In the case of Vietnam, number one is friendly, number two is technological advance, number three is free and democratic. And in the case of Indonesia, number one is technological advanced, so it echoes through the big data, high tech. And number two is liberal. Number three is advanced in medical and health service. Number three is respect the cultural diversity. In the case of Thailand, we enjoy 4.1. And the perception is respect for law and order. The second one is the friendly. The third one is technologically advanced. Last year, we did the survey in Singapore. The top three perception, including friendly, respect of multiculturalism, and then liberal and democracy. So to sum up, the perception of Taiwan among these four countries are friendly, respectful of multiculturalism, and liberal and democracy, democratic. So this is the result that we took the pride to share with our audience and also the distinguished panelists. And We are very frank and to not only to demonstrate the top three perception, but also to summarize the last three perception, which means that Taiwan needs to work harder, including in the case of Vietnam, is generous and open and free. In the case of Indonesia, it's free and democratic, wealthy and friendly. And for Thailand and for Singapore, compared with Singapore, of course, Taiwan is not that rich. So rich, open-minded, and healthcare is advanced. So these are the country profile of how Taiwan has been perceived with the last three perception. When it comes to the Taiwan business image, we also follow the same pattern to do the dichotomy in comparison. I know time is almost there, so I will do it very quickly to wrap up. So yeah. Those numbers, we're happy to share with you after the forum. So if you are interested in those information, please let us know. We will send you the soft copy. But the most interesting issue that we would like to share with you is we are not only conduct the Taiwan focus survey, but to compare with Taiwan among the foreign top foreign investor in respective country. For example, in Vietnam's top 10 foreign investor, Taiwan ranked number 2 among all. And Taiwan, the image of Taiwan business rank also number 2 among the top 10. But when it comes to Indonesia, due to the different survey method, so the ranking is not as good as other country, but that's due to the technical issue. And also Indonesia is too big, too large. So the rank among the 10 foreign investor in Indonesia, Taiwan image rank number 8. And Taiwan business image rank number 6. But we follow the same pattern and method in the case of Vietnam. We return to Thailand and we are happy to collect those information. Now Taiwan rank. Number 1 out of the 11 foreign investor. And Taiwan's business image rank also number 1. When it comes to Singapore, Taiwan ranked number 3 out of the 15 foreign investors and also ranked number 2 among the 15 regarding the Taiwan's business image. Okay, I know that my colleague has raised 100 times of the time up board. So I also come across very quickly the new southbound policy matter. For the previous table that summarized that how Taiwan has been perceived and how our business has been perceived. But during the past 7 years, the new southbound policy facilitated the multifaceted partnership with our partner country. And we also proposed those questionnaires to our respondent. And most of them are very aware of the new southbound policy and also believe that the new southbound policy will facilitate a closer tie between Taiwan and the region. And apart from those new southbound policy, during the past 3 years, the COVID-19 pandemic also has been the challenge for the regional country. And Taiwan's image during the period that through the provision of the resources and medical assistance, that also give a very positive impression to Taiwan. So Taiwan's public health resilience navigating through the pandemic, and also our resources sharing as a reliable partner for new southbound policy country has been recognized and facilitating an even better image of Taiwan and its business. Okay, the wrap up. The image of Taiwan and our Taiwan business are correlated. As a middle power, Taiwan's performance works well and contribution works well and enjoy a trustworthy image. And Taiwanese business has been a key stakeholder in a regional production network as well as the global supply chain. However, the survey has been regarded as a gentle reminder to our business and our government that we still need to work harder in the field of corporate social responsibility, environmental protection, and taking better care of the local worker. Although those companies has already taken good care of the local worker, but we need to take better care. And the people-centered new Southbound policy help promote a better image of Taiwan, while the warm power practice matters in facilitating the connectivity between Taiwan and the neighbors, that is all of you. Finally, thank you for your attention and hope you do enjoy the 2023 Yushan Forum and your stay in Taiwan. I'm truly sorry for the delay.
Thank you, Alan. And before I call it a day, I believe people in Taiwan is very punctual. And so actually, we have only 10 minutes left. So let me call for questions. Is anyone would love to have your questions? Oh, here, there's a lady. And please identify yourself and keep your question short.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. 谢谢你们，您好。我是鬼岛之音独立媒体 Emily， 您好，谢谢。我是想请教两位艺术家，一个艺术管理者，还有教育家。当我们讲到在艺术传承，还有在教育的时候，在讲国家级的 project 的专案的时候，我们怎么去平衡？一个是独立文化的价值，就是我们自己的文化传承 ，versus， 去做一些跟国际上串联国际共同的社会的趋势跟挑战，比如说在舞蹈的话，共融舞蹈，或是说如果是在艺术的话，是可能不同的社会现在面临的趋势跟挑战，基本上怎么 balance 我们cultural preservation versus new progressive values that binds us together. Thank you.
Thank you, Ebony. 院长先来吧，别客气。他艺术管理行政的，Ebony, your question is for Director Shao, right? And also Professor Zhang. Yeah, 那个。肖院长您来没？不不。
Okay. 对不起，我还是用中文哈。那个基本上来讲，我讲。我们都会说博物馆，在博物馆研究说博物馆是一个国家意识形态的工具。那过去的话，博物馆是为了宣扬所谓的整个国家民族的一个尊荣。可是在现代的博物馆，基本上来讲的话，它的使命已经改变了。基本上来讲，它是作为一个社会沟通的工具。那在故宫博物院来讲的话，当然故宫博物院大家知道故宫博物院的源流，那它当然就是说很多的是华夏文物。可是对于一个博物馆来讲的话，我们传递的是一个普世的价值，是一个多元文化的价值。所以在这个部分的话，虽然国立故宫博物院的话它是公立的博物馆，可是实际上它是一个最接近 NGO 的形式跟社会对话的一个组织，或是说一个机构。所以这个部分的话，我们不会把现在的故宫博物院，不会把国家的意识形态作为一个跟民众沟通或是所谓的传输的工具，而是说我们是作为对话跟相互了解的一个界面。所以为什么故宫博物院办了很多新南向这些国家的一个活动，基本上来讲的话就以这样的一个逻辑思考去作为。
谢谢张校长，张教授，谢谢。
在艺术教育当中，传承跟发展都很重要，但它 但它也是两个不同的范畴。那作为传承来讲，它是有种像博物馆似的，就是说你不要去改动它，因为任何被改动的东西都是一个新的发展，它不是原本意义上的东西。所以我们在艺术教育当中，作为源头的东西，我们会是我们很重要的一个部分，因为这是台湾的文化，或者这是属于亚洲的一个文化，但是在艺术发展当中，很重要的是不停能够打破跟创新，因为它作为一种沟通或者作为一种表达工具，它起到一个语言所不能那个达成的那个功能，做一个沟通的工具来讲，用身体，用一个舞台的形象，去传递某些讯息，或者去跟不同的文化做一个交流。我想这个才是艺术发展当中的一个重点。那另外一个就是怎么样对未来有一些想象，这也是艺术发展当中的一个课题。比方说我们今天晚上在国家剧院，郑仲龙会跟日本的艺术家合作，用一种新的科技手段跟舞蹈结合，去探讨人类未来。那黄奕呢是走的另外一条路线，他自己编写程序，让那个 Kuka就机器人能够达成跟舞者一样的质感的动作。那这个会对科技有未来的什么样的影响呢？这个其实也是可以期待的。所以我想不管是我们的学生到偏乡去跟偏乡的那个就是比较弱势的群体去做这种文化的沟通，还是新南向，还是走向国际，我想这种文化的沟通是应该是更是一种心灵跟心灵的连接，跟对未来一个想象。谢谢。
Thank you all. And I would love to have some more time. Oh goodness, two questions from here. The lady first, and then the gentleman, and please also identify yourself. Yeah. Keep your questions very short. Very, very short.
Thank you so much. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Elia from Indonesia. I want to ask a question to Dr. Ellen. So we met in July in the CISA Forum. Thank you so much for inviting me to this forum. So my question is, Taiwan business is already well known in Indonesia. The image is very good, but the general people do not know much about Taiwan. So what is the type of strategy to enhance people-to-people partnership? Because I believe that is one of the core of NSP. So what is the type of strategy to enhance people-to-people partnership between Taiwan and Indonesia especially? Thank you so much.
Thank you. And the gentleman's question too.
Hello, good afternoon. I'm Jocel from the Philippines. I'm also the same with Elia. We are the same from the same delegation in the CSAT Youth Camp, and we are both chosen to participate in this forum. My question is more specific on the Philippines, although it's kind of similar to Elia's question. The youths that I've known in the Philippines, or maybe the Philippines in general, are somehow indifferent to the presence of Taiwan, and they also are not really aware that the drink that they love, milk tea, Filipinos are really into milk tea, originates from Taiwan. So I was thinking, will Taiwan conduct another survey on the Philippines on how they perceive Taiwan to perhaps create a plan to make sure that Taiwan will be more felt to the Philippines? I want to investigate on what Dr. Alan has in this. Thank you so much.
Thank you. So these two questions are for Alan. Please.
Okay, thank you very much. 3 minutes, please. Thank you very much for the two wonderful questions. For the first one, from our friends from Indonesia and also the alumni of our CISA camp, I will say that how TAEF can facilitate and contribute to the new southbound policy in the Indonesia. Indonesia enjoy a very vast territory. And also the amount of the population is 260 million people in Indonesia. So it will be difficult to reach out to every neighborhood or every corner. The strategy that we TAEF has been promoting and emphasizing is to establish the long-term partnership with our friend and institution, partner institution. Since last year, we met the PJ Foundation's colleague in Tokyo, in line with the Nippon Foundation's Asian Philanthropy Congress. And since then, we committed to promote the bilateral exchange. And this year, we took the pleasure to host the delegation from PJ, which is a very important foundation in Indonesia, emphasizing on the future young talent cultivation and promotion of smart agriculture that echo to the goal of the new Southbound policy. So I think this is something that to invest in a long-term commitment and long-term partnership with the key think tank, civil society organization, and the society leader, the social leader, especially the young leaders such as our friends here, are important to what TAEF can do based on our 5 core action plan. And I think this is a very short answer to your question, and we can discuss that later after the forum. And for our friends from the Philippines, yes, we do consider to have our annual image survey in Philippines. Since the previous 5 cases are in Southeast Asia, and Philippines is our very close friend, and we do hope to learn from our friend how Taiwan has been perceived and what kind of the issue that we need to improve ourselves. So I would say that this survey result are regarded as the gentle reminder sent by our partner and neighbors so that we can, according to those recommendations and advice, we can enhance our self-improvement and to be a better neighbor to our Indo-Pacific partners. And I do believe that TAEF has been committed to the long-term commitment and partnership, not the one-shot interaction. And that is the reason why we invite the very active young leader from our CSAP camp this summer to take part in the Yushan Forum so that they can encounter different global leaders and also meet with their senior friends from their countries, and so that we can enrich the social network to enhance the people-to-people connectivity. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Well said, Alan. And thank you, everyone. I think time's up, but the relationship will keep going. And I was told that we still have 20 minutes, so everyone can visit the exhibition if you haven't. But if you have more questions, please stay. So after this panel, we can discuss more. And so I'm going to call it a day. And thank you for the TAEF. Thank you for everyone's participate. And also thank you for our wonderful panelists. Thank you.
Thank you to the moderator and the panelists for the wonderful discussion. And now I'd like to invite our moderator and the panelists to move to the center of the stage for a photo call. Thank you once again for the insightful discussions. Thank you. Please stand closer and look at the cameras in your front. All right, please look at our photographers. 3, 2, 1, cheese. And give us one more with your thumbs up. All right. 帮我们伸出大拇指比个赞. Please look at the photographers. 3, 2, 1, cheese. Thank you. Another round of applause to our moderator and panelists. Thank you very much.